He has long been a key player in New Hampshire business and politics, and now he's one of the highest-ranking Granite Staters in the federal government. Assistant Secretary of Commerce Rich Ashooh joins us today. Thanks for being here, Rich.
Adam, thanks for having me.
We appreciate it. So you're known as one of the nicest guys in New Hampshire politics. You weren't exactly the biggest Trump supporter in 2016. How did you end up getting to yes with this job and with President Trump?
Well, thank you for the compliment. I will say... One thing that I think might surprise a lot of people is the emphasis on qualifications that this administration has really pushed. You know, the president, agree or disagree, comes out of a world where results matter, and that has definitely taken hold in the administration. This cabinet is a very effective cabinet, and certainly the Secretary of Commerce, whom I'm very proud to work with, is Wilbur Ross, and someone who's certainly well suited to understand what makes this economy tick, and is someone I'm proud to work with. And so I'm honored to be there, in particular for that reason, because we care about results.
So you're with the Bureau of Industry and Security. It can sound like a bland name, but this is actually some pretty interesting work that you're doing. Explain what the mission is there.
Sure. I think, you know, most people, when they think of the Department of Commerce, they think of, you know, an agency that's dedicated, as it is, to growing the economy, growing exports, you know, really, you know, putting pedal to the metal on the economy. But within the Department of Commerce is a national security arm that is actually focused on tapping the brakes a bit to make sure that in our zeal to grow our economy, that we're making sure that important technologies are, you know, remain in U.S. hands, that the American advantage in those technologies remains relative to our adversary nations. But in particular, we have a very strong non-proliferation role. We want to make sure that we're not inadvertently contributing to the growth in threats to the nation through our exports.
And how do you draw that line where allowing business to do what it does best and be profitable while also keeping that national security component in mind?
Yeah, you certainly have to understand business and you have to understand technology, and we have mechanisms to help us do that. But it is never a snapshot. This is a continuing play that unfolds. And so we're constantly working with, you know, emerging technologies and companies that produce them and to ensure that we're really staying ahead of that fight. Businesses who want to export and find themselves in need of an export license might find that to be a nuisance. And our job is to really ensure that they understand why we do that. And it is for that non-proliferation role.
And weapons of mass destruction, that's a word that, you know, triggers a lot of scary images for people. You guys have to keep track of the sort of component technologies that go into this that could be exported. Give us an example of what sort of things that you're keeping track of, products or even raw materials that you have to make sure are not going into the wrong hands.
Sure. Well, we govern our export controls through what we call regimes, and they're focused on those particular areas. So there's a missile control regime, and that was created to work with other nations who share our goal to keep very potent missiles out of the wrong hands. That was started in response to the Scud issue that we were experiencing back in the late 80s. Well, as you can probably guess, missile technologies evolved all along the way, but we've actually done a pretty good job of staying on top of that evolving technology. But we wouldn't be able to do it without having really strong alliances with whom we work. And that applies to chemical, nuclear, of course, now one of our biggest challenges is ensuring that the dual-use technologies that we govern, some can be used for very good things, like cyber technology. We wouldn't function without it. But in the wrong hands, with bad actors, cyber technology can be used to do very dangerous things.
We know that the president has sort of said he wants to reorder the map and sort of change the stance, I guess, of the United States globally in relation to NATO. He said some things that have alarmed sort of the national security establishment. Has the stance changed at all in terms of the countries we're dealing with and the technologies you're keeping track of? Are we changing our stance to companies or countries at all, Russia, Iran, things like that?
Well, it's interesting. 30 years ago, when I was a young staffer on Capitol Hill and paying attention to these issues, technology transfer, non-proliferation, we were worried about three nations in particular: Iran, China, and at the time, Soviet Union. And I find my day is taken up with the very same three nations. Now, that is a good thing in that we've kept them at bay. Our export controls and our alliances have worked. But as I said, this is not something that you declare victory and go home. So we need to maintain those relationships because, again, it would be very, very hard to do this alone.
This is very serious stuff. Your agency was just involved in helping secure the conviction of a CEO who's conspiring to sell specialty metals to Iran. What's interesting, though, is it seems like some of the penalties, we have 3 to 5 years for these things. Is it odd that, you know, some of these things we would think of as very serious, you know, doing business in a sensitive area with a adversary of the United States, is getting a lesser sentence than somebody might get at U.S. District Court in Concord for selling fentanyl?
Well, we, you know, try to use our penalties to be effective, and, you know, that means, you know, primarily as a deterrent. But we also had the largest export control related penalty in history, and that was $1 billion fine to a company called ZTE. And that was Iran was the kind of nation of concern in that case as well. So the fines and the penalties, they need to be adjusted appropriately to, you know, ensure compliance going forward. But again, it never stops. And in fact, after these convictions, you know, in many cases, we maintain a hand on the circumstances to ensure that, you know, the things that we're worried about don't actually occur.
Mm-hmm. Do you worry that the waning patriotism that we see in our culture, that sort of the values that helped the United States win the Cold War, as those erode a little bit, do you worry that more businesses will sort of not really care too much about the national security interests and just go for that almighty dollar?
So I don't worry about waning patriotism, especially, you know, having shown up now, it's been, you know, just over a couple of months. And you feel the patriotism very strongly in the bureau I work in, and I'm very proud to be working with these people. Having said that, the nature of our economy certainly has changed. We talk about the global marketplace, but the fact of the matter is, the world has become a smaller place, and it's tempting to think of the world of commerce as something, you know, well beyond the borders of the United States. But there's a reason why the United States is the most powerful economy in the world, and that is something to be proud of. That is a patriotic thought, and we should never lose sight of it.
You mentioned Russia, China, and Iran. Which one of those countries is giving us the most trouble right now at your bureau?
At my bureau, it's certainly China. And this is not a secret in any way. They have a publicly declared strategy to overtake the United States' technology dominance. In particular, in the field of semiconductors, they've announced a $150 billion fund to help fuel that takeover. So it's not a secret. They're very, very open about it. And I would say that the majority of my day is taken up in one way or another with some sort of Chinese ambition as far as U.S. technology goes.
This is fascinating stuff. Rich Ashooh, Assistant Secretary of Commerce at the Bureau of Industry and Security. This is a sort of a lesser-known front of national security, but crucial nonetheless.
It sure is.
All right.
Sure is.
Thank you so much for coming in.
Oh, it was great to be here. Good to see you.
All the best.